On October 3rd, 1984, the NASL played its final game at Toronto's Varsity Stadium. Game 2 of the best-of-3 Soccer Bowl final between the hometown Blizzard and the Chicago Sting ended in a 3-2 win for the Sting. Less than 6 months later, the league was dead. The Blizzard were one of only two teams left standing. Many Canadians look back at the NASL era, and they consider it a failure. Their memories are influenced by the spectacular crash and burn of teams like the New York Cosmos. However, the NASL had a long and successful history here in Canada. Yeah, there were some failures, and the run was inconsistent, but overall, the legacy of the NASL in Canada was positive. Two times Canadian teams ended as champions, the Toronto Metros Croatia, that's the same club that eventually would be known as the Blizzard, won the 1976 Soccer Bowl. The Vancouver Whitecaps, they were the 1979 Soccer Bowl champions. Both of those clubs were there to the very bitter end of the 1984 season. As we said before, the Blizzard, along with the Minnesota Strikers, were one of the only two teams in NASL that didn't actually fold at the end. But the ultimate measure of the NASL in Canada was seen in the performance of the Canadian men's national team. During the run of the league, Canada was arguably the second best team in CONCACAF. They took Brazil, mighty Brazil, to penalties in the 1984 Olympic quarterfinal. And that was before the Olympic tournament was a U23 tournament, so that's the full team. And of course, the 1986 Canadian men's national team played in Mexico in the World Cup, the one and only time this country has been there. The backbone of those teams played in the NASL. As much as the death of the NASL hurt our friends in the United States, it arguably hurt us more. Canada lost the most the day the NASL died. To honor the importance of the NASL to Canadian soccer, here, on the 30th anniversary of the final season of that league, the Two Solitudes has revisited it. We've talked to three different people that were either there that night when the league died in 1984 or were deeply involved. We hope that that by doing this, we can help Canadians remember the positive that was the NASL. Yeah, there was some negatives, as we pointed out before, but we want you to remember how positive, how much influence, how good, how much it mattered to Canadian soccer, because we're staring down a possibility of the NASL once again having a great influence in this league if the 1A league comes to fruition. We thank you for listening. This is the Two Solitudes Podcast.
Live from Varsity Stadium in Toronto, Ontario, Sports Vision presents the NASL Soccer Bowl Game 2. Tonight, the Chicago Sting versus the Toronto Blizzard.
Welcome to a special Two Solitudes edition where we celebrate, as I said in the intro, the NASL so-called 1.0 era, Kevin. Before we get going, Kevin Laramie joins me as always. How are you today, Kevin?
I'm doing great. I have a lot of memories, Duane. When I was a kid watching the NASL with, wait a minute. No, I don't. I was not even here.
I was about to say, I was about to call you on that one, Kevin. I do have a few memories of it, although they are a little faint. The Blizzard weren't on TV a ton, but I always remember cheering for them when they were. They were my team, and I certainly remember them in their second run in the CSL. But we decided, Kevin and I were talking off air last week, and we just sort of, I made my favorite little trivia reference that the NASL's final ever game was played in Toronto, which is not something I think a lot of people know. And we just sort of got it talking and thought, you know what, we should recognize that. We should recognize the 30th anniversary of the end of this league before the end of the year. And, you know, we quickly put this together from that, and I hope you do enjoy it. Kevin, I think that the one thing that I really, and I said this in the intro, wanted to stress is how important both the NASL was for Canada, and I think how Canada was for the NASL. This country contributed a lot to that league, to have two of the, there were only five or six teams running into the final season, and two of them were Canadian. Two of the more successful teams in the 80s in the NASL were the Whitecaps and the Blizzard. Blizzard went to back-to-back championships. I know people want to make jokes about Toronto and soccer right now, but it wasn't always as bad as TFC. And Montreal also was involved at that time. Had huge crowds in the 80s as well.
Yeah, I remember I was not there, but I have a couple of friends who were there, and they sent me their thoughts and their email about that. Like, Pierre Maillot, thanks for your email, saying they remember in 1981 going to a game against this thing. 58,000 people, 500 and something people at the Big O for a soccer game in the early 80s on the very hard turf. And it was basically the grass that, not a grass, the turf that the Expos were playing on. Anyways, it was a very different time, and the Manic had a very big crowd. Same thing for Toronto, same thing for Vancouver. It's almost an era that's been forgotten in a way. Watching those images and those replays or recap on YouTube, it's very impressive how many people were actually into the NASL.
Yeah, absolutely. And look, I mean, part of my reason that I became a soccer fan as much as I am is because, as I've said many times before, my mother's family was English, and I was influenced a lot by that culture, and that's why I became a fan. But that said, I always remember soccer not being fought, like not having people fight against it in the way that you often hear other people's memories. That because of the Blizzard and the NASL when I was young, I think, at least part of it, people were accepting that it was a sport. It maybe wasn't a sport that they loved, or maybe not the most popular sport, but it was a sport that was just part of the sporting landscape, and it was accepted in that way. So it was acceptable for me as a Canadian kid with some English heritage to follow this game and to follow it locally, and that was the key thing. I think that it provided a lot of people that are my age with something local to attach themselves to, which ultimately then led them attaching themselves to following the national team as well. And there was that era between the NASL with the brief bleep of the CSL, and maybe we'll do a show on the CSL one day, but not today.
No, you're right. And people have still to this day, they think, oh, the NASL was just a small soccer league. But no, teams were good. There was big stars. And like Bruce Wilson's going to say a little later on this show, well, Canada, that kind of... Those NASL team, when they played those big teams from Europe or North America, well, they actually played well and they got good results, and it was very entertaining soccer.
Yeah, and as I was saying, that yeah, I think that we lost that for a lot of years, and people didn't have that local connection, which we're just starting to reestablish now. You know, when TFC started in 2007, although TFC's done a lot of things wrong on the field, off the field, they did create early a culture that started to revive that, and, mm-hmm. and we're seeing it now. But Kevin, as you said, Bruce Wilson is one of the people that are going to lend their voice to the show. Bruce Wilson was Canada's captain, basically. He was the captain of the 1986 team. He played, I believe, the second most appearances in NASL history. Yep. A guy that's perfect to talk to when you're talking about the legacy of NASL in Canada. We also have a fellow by the name of Dave Bailey. Dave was deeply involved in the Blizzard Supporters Club at the time. He was the man who delivered the tickets to all the desperate supporters in the bar before the game of that final game. So we talked to Dave about the experiences of the night and just what it was like to be a fan of soccer back then. We talked to Bruce about what it was like to play and what it meant to the Canadian national team. And we also talked to Bob Lenarduzzi from the Whitecaps, who is... You know, when I wrote to the Whitecaps requesting him, I said, there's really only one voice or one name that you could think of when you want to talk about the legacy of the NASL in Canada and legacy of any soccer in Canada. And it's Bob Lenarduzzi, who's been there in all of its installments. So he obviously was a voice that we needed to talk to as well.
You're right. It was fun talking to all those guys, Duane, because each individually added something, and they all were back in their memories too, thinking about it, talking about it, and you can tell that in their voice, they were back in 1984. They were back playing. They had that emotion. And you can tell that that league had a very strong effect on those people.
All right, so after a quick break, we're going to come back, and the voice you will hear will be Dave Bailey, who was a member of the Supporters Club, was in the stands that day, and still, if you know Dave, and Dave's a friend of mine, we'll still talk fondly of those days watching the Blizzard.
An exclusive Sports Vision presentation. Monday night in Chicago's Comiskey Park, Manny Rojas scored the decisive goal in the Sting's 2-1 victory, and the celebration began. Sting coach Willie Roy hopes, however, that the celebration was not premature, for Chicago is still one game away from the championship crown. Now the scene is Toronto's Varsity Stadium, and the Blizzard, down one game to none, should come out fighting for their lives. With the North American Soccer League's championship on the line, will it be a Sting sweep, or will Toronto's Blizzard send the series back to Chicago? Don't Don't go away.
And welcome back to our special Two Solitudes NASL 1.0, 30th anniversary of the end of the NASL show. We got Dave Bailey, who was a fan in the stands on the very last game ever played in the NASL. Dave, thanks for joining us today.
Great to be here, Duane.
Dave is also Dave's a friend of mine. I've known him for several years. He's a TFC season ticket holder, so I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, exactly.
But, yeah, Dave, talk about what your memories of that final game that was held here in Toronto were.
Well, it was electric. We were behind the eight ball. We'd lost the first game of what was going to be a best, was hopefully going to be a best of three series for the first time, and as it turned out, the only time. Chicago won 2-1 in Chicago, playing in one of the baseball stadiums. There were an incredible number of yellow cards by David Socha, the referee for that match, who you might remember as the referee who called Canada's goal against Brazil back in the Olympics in L.A., same man. But it was electric. We met at the Duke of York, as we always did, the supporters club, the Blizzard Supporters Club, and we were allocated a certain number of season tickets by the club to sell there. And the place was packed even before I got there with the tickets, and I couldn't get in until I told them I had the tickets, and they let me in, or else there would have been a riot there. There were hundreds of people in the Duke of York, which in those days was only the basement level of that building. If anyone goes to Duke of York now, it's a much bigger facility. We were asked by the Blizzard to try and get the gang over to the stadium early because they had something special they wanted to do, which they did, and that was when the Blizzard were introduced. They came out with sign cards, letter cards, thanks Blizzard fans. There was a huge roar from the crowd. It was absolutely electric up until the time Chicago scored two consecutive goals and put us behind the eight ball, which was not so good. But it got better. John Paskin came into the game as a substitute in the second half. I hope I'm not jumping ahead too much for you, Duane, here.
Just continue, Dave. Yeah, we want to hear your memories of the game specifically, and then we'll ask a few questions from there.
There was a substitution second half. We're down 2-0. John Paskin, who was a South African striker, he had just joined the club that year. He had a good year with the team, actually. Only played 16 games due to injury, but he scored 10 goals. Almost Jermaine Defoe stats, if you want to put it that way. It was a great set piece, 20 yards from the goal.
It was.
David Byrne, another South African, lined up over the ball, overran it. Ismet Salingwe, a legendary South African, drilled a free kick purposely about 4 yards outside the far post. Paskin ran in on it, got great height on his leap, headed it almost straight down under Nguera, Victor Nguera, the Chicago goaltender. And it was a beautiful goal. It was nice to set pieces you want to see. I recommend anybody take a look on YouTube if they can find that. It's well worth seeing. 4 minutes later, the Blizzard would tie it up. It was Bruce Wilson with a through ball to Ismet Salingwe, knocked it back to David Byrne, who looped it forward to Roberto Bettica, the legendary Italian striker who had joined the club from Juventus the year before. And he took it on the full volley inside the left foot inside the far post. It was his last goal of his career, and of course it was the last Blizzard goal because not too many minutes after that, a bit of a fluky goal. Chicago scored on a deflection off the Blizzard's Swedish defender, Connie Carlson, the Swedish international, and that was 3-2, and that was that. And a bit of a letdown at the end, but the intensity in the stadium, the crowd noise, when Bettega particularly scored that goal, it was incredible. And I still don't feel that we've had that kind of excitement at any point in time, that noise at any TFC game.
Dave, I wanted to talk a bit about the fans. And the perception amongst those that are maybe don't remember the NASL, aren't old enough to remember, is that it died out, it fizzled out at the end. There wasn't any interest at all. But I think that it's interesting that the Canadian teams anyway, there did seem to be a supporters culture around that league right to the very end. Talk about that. How popular were the Blizzard in that final year?
It's a bit tough to judge. The supporters club was there and what always was. It wasn't as big as supporters clubs that exist now. It wasn't RPB. It was maybe a bit more like U Sector in that sense. It was there. But general attendance was not what we expected it to be. From 79 to 83, the Blizzard played at the CME. And probably in about 82, 83, they sort of peaked out at around 15,000 average. They'd had a couple of really bad years. I mean, I think it was 1981, the team was 7-25, so attendance went down to about 8,000 a game. Pretty poor. They moved to Varsity in 84, expecting good things to happen. Nice grass field, seats are close to the stands. They averaged about 11-3, so it wasn't great. I believe they made it a little better for themselves, but they didn't pay for the house as much as they used to at the X. That was the story that was going around at the time. There were about 16-5 at that final in a 21,000-seat stadium, so it still wasn't sold out. The atmosphere was great, but I guess you'd say the south end wasn't very full. And it was a strange year. I mean, if you have a chance to ever talk to Bobby Lenarduzzi about this, in 1983, the Whitecaps were drawing 30,000 a game. In 1984, their attendance dropped to about 13,000 a game.
What happened in 1 year?
Well, I think part of the thing was that I think in 83 they had just moved into BC Place. So it was the new stadium, in fact. And they had a couple of really big crowds that may have moved the average up. I'd have to look at the rosters to see if they lost some of their stars who may have affected things as well. I wouldn't be the person to know the answer to that question. It's just when you look at the numbers, you go, wow. And something similar happened to the Cosmos around that time, too. Believe it or not, the Cosmos were playing in front of 12,000 average at Giant Stadium that year. Not good.
If we look at the rosters from those days, the team had names that struck our imagination till this day. Even me, who I'm 30 this year, which means I was born back then. I know those names because of the history. How can you explain the level of play that the NASL had in the mid-80s that people don't understand today, that it was basically the first division of North America?
It was. It definitely was. And it was good. And we can always say this when teams come over from overseas for friendlies. Even now, they may be on a vacation, whatever. But the NASL pretty much always held its own against those clubs. The New York Cosmos used to have their they called it the Transatlantic Cup, and they'd bring over Barca and teams like that to play. It was good. The Blizzard had a guy like Roberto Bettega on the team. Granted, he had just come back from injury, and he was getting near the end of the line. But he had been a star for Juventus, a star for the Italian national team. He missed the 82 World Cup because he was rehabbing a knee injury, or else he would have been part of that team. The quality of play was pretty good. A little too much time in the air, much like MLS now, a little bit too bouncy off heads, three or four in a row. It was like, get it on the ground, let's play. So that would have been my complaint there. But if you look at any of the highlight reels, it wasn't bad, and there were some real stars playing in the league at different times. In 84, Canalia had already retired from New York Cosmos. He wasn't playing. So that might have been part of the problem in New York, because he had been such a superstar. Some of the goals he scored for them, just phenomenal. In 1 year, I think he scored 50, if you combine playoffs and the league together. If you go on YouTube, there is a reel of all 50 goals that he scored that year. So, how to explain it? Well, there was a lot of money floating around. People paying for people like Gerd Müller to come over and play in Florida. It didn't help, though. It didn't help financially. And that's why people have always said the MLS has the right idea by trying to keep salaries down, at least on average anyway. Eventually the high salaries did make it pretty tough for the NASL to continue to exist. When you had one team particularly, and maybe a couple of others on the edge of that, putting up so much money.
Absolutely. What would you consider the legacy of NASL 1.0 that we can still see to this day?
You know, that's a tough one because the gap was so big. I mean, from a Canadian standpoint, we don't get to Mexico in 86 without the NASL, right? We don't get there. All our players, virtually all our players, had matured as players in the North American Soccer League. You know, the young guys like Paul James and Randy Reagan, who were so effective in midfield for Canada, they don't get that opportunity if they don't have somewhere to play. And the NASL gave them that opportunity. I remember when they started, Colin Miller would be another one, Trevor McCallum, Pasquale DeLuca, a bunch of young Canadians came up through the Blizzards, Sven Haberman. Where would they have played to get good enough to be able to help us get to a World Cup if there was no NASL, right?
Right.
I mean, it was. We don't get there without the NASL. And we the only reason we got close in 94 was because of the CSL. There's a parallel there. You know, players had places to play.
Yeah.
So, but the big gap between NASL and MLS, the big gap in time, I'm not sure how much. I think MLS learned more from the mistakes of the NASL. I think that might be the legacy as much as anything else.
Dave,
I mean, we knew that you could draw the big crowds, but could you sustain it? And NASL couldn't.
Dave, I want to take us back to that night in question, the final game ever played in the NASL. When the final whistle went off, was there a feeling in the stands that it was over, or was there still hope at that time?
Well, there was still hope. The Blizzard had been taking deposits, or were about to start taking deposits on season tickets for the next year. You could put down $25 and lock in your season ticket. I mean, obviously, there was not going to be any problem getting a season ticket. It's not like TFC now, or what TFC was a couple of years ago, maybe. But the and if I recall correctly, they had sold thousands. So there was a lot of excitement in Toronto, but there was also a lot of fear. I know Vancouver, I don't remember when they announced that they were going to take a year off, but they did. And that was a stake to your heart. The year before, Montreal had dropped out. That hurt a lot because Montreal, what year would it have been, 82, for a playoff match against Chicago, drew 55,000 people into the Big O. And the footage of that, it was just amazing.
Yep.
They loved that team. And then, for whatever reason, the owners decided they were going to change the name to Team Canada. They hadn't done that, but it killed Montreal. In 83, their attendance average since dropped from something like 26 down to 8.
Wow.
So there were a lot of strange decisions going on back then. But in terms of our nervousness, a lot of nervousness. There was always hope. I mean, and we were following closely. I mean, you figured Clive Toy had done so much that he could pull anything out of a hat. And that's what we were hoping. And they even talked about joining up with the American Soccer League, what few teams that were still existed from the NASL, that they would join up with the ASL. But four teams, at the end of that season, four teams jumped over to major indoor soccer.
The indoor phenomena was interesting. What was the feeling at that time, if you can remember back? I mean, I know you can't put yourself into the minds of those that made the decisions, but why was there such a move towards the indoor game, do you think?
Well, of course, the NASL tried running some indoor seasons, and I don't know, it wasn't real soccer, right? I mean, I think we all feel that now, too, looking at it. I mean, it died out. I mean, there are some indoor soccer leagues playing in the U.S. and the hockey leagues now, but it's small-time stuff. It's not like it was. For the MISL there got pretty big for a while. You know, a lot of sold-out stadiums and, 10 and 12,000 crowds and things like that. I don't know what people saw in that. To me, it just wasn't soccer. It was something different. And I think that's why it didn't really go over here in Toronto. You know, I do recall being at Maple Leaf Gardens for at least one crowd of about 12 or 13,000 people. And that was pretty exciting, and it was a lot of fun. But there were a lot of crowds of 3,000 and 4,000 people as well at Maple Leaf Gardens. So I don't really understand it, and I know that it just messed things up as far as I was concerned. It kept Branko Sagota away from Canada for the 86 World Cup. You know, he joined the team pretty much during the tournament, and he wasn't fit to play outdoors. So I'll always have a bit of a a bit of a hate on for the NISL, I think.
Dave, if I want to talk about the gap years between the start of MLS back in Canada and I guess the CSL, we can put it in there. So there's kind of two gaps there. As a fan, as a hardcore fan, as someone who was deeply involved with the Blizzard, you know, what was your feeling during those years? Did you have hope throughout them that we'd eventually get back to having a situation like that? Or was it just something that you'd given up on by that time, by the time 2006 rolled around and TFC had been finally got to back into MLS?
Yeah, I was really much in a I'll believe it when I see it type of a thing. I really didn't think MLS was ever going to come to Canada. I really didn't think it was going to happen. I mean, you know, I kept following the Blizzard. The Blizzard didn't die. The Blizzard existed in the National Soccer League, the Ethnic League, in 1986, and then joined the CSL, of course, 87 to 93, was it, Duane?
Yeah, I believe so, yeah.
And then did one more year in the American Professional Soccer League, along with Vancouver and Montreal, and four American clubs. And the hope had been at the time, and this actually gave us a little bit of hope, and that was that league was applying for Division I status. For after the World Cup in the USA. And they didn't get it. And I think that didn't help. We felt pretty bleak then. It was, you know, I didn't think it was ever going to happen, so I was a bit surprised when it did.
And when it did, I mean, hindsight and all that, but now that we've had TFC and we've had MLS in this country for a while, you know, do you feel that is something that can eventually get us back to the heights of what the NASL was providing for the Canadian national team? Or are you one of those people that think that we need to find a solution of our own in addition to the MLS teams at this point?
Well, I like the concept that you had mentioned about a Canadian NASL division or something of that sort, or Canadian NASL level league. I think that would be very good. We have the talk of that you talked about at Hamilton, I guess. We've had we've heard the talk about Toronto even, and that wouldn't be. I don't think that would be a bad thing at all. I think something important that needs to happen is MLS has to start recognizing Canadians and Americans as equals, and that would give us some hope as well. Whether a lot more Canadians would end up playing or not, I'm not sure, but at least it would open some doors. I mean, and as I mentioned, I mean, one of the things I didn't touch on was the NASL had its domestic policy. You had to have three North Americans on the field at all times, right? Mm-hmm. So if you took Bruce Wilson off, you would have to put on another North American to replace him. People think that's kind of weird, and I suppose it is in its way, but it made sure that North Americans were getting the opportunities. I mean, like I said, I mean, I mentioned some of the names. I mean, James Miller, Randy Reagan, Charlie Falzon, Pasquale De Luca, Trevor McCallum, the young Canadians. I mean, there were older ones too, like the Bruce Wilsons, but the young guys, Sven Haverman, they wouldn't have ever matured the way they did without that league and without the opportunities. And the Blizzard deserve a lot of credit, I think, for playing as many young guys as they did and getting and having success with them. But and you know, to a degree, Toronto FC has been doing that. It would be nice if we could get that happening or have more doors open for these Canadians. And three teams with the two or three guys per team or less that are playing regularly isn't enough. So I would love to see an NASL, like you mentioned, happening.
Dave, we'll end it with this because I know you've taken some gracious enough to take some time away from your work schedule this morning. If you close your eyes and think back to your years following the Blizzard in the NASL, what would be your favorite memory from that time? If you could pinpoint one moment, if you had a time machine that you could go back and relive.
I'd say there's two. Obviously, the Bettega goal in that last game, the joy that was in that stand. I mean, you know, just the explosion of energy that took place, the emotion that was happening. It said, you know, this is real. This could be happening more often here. You know, if it doesn't die, this can only grow in Toronto. I'm not saying for the league, but for Toronto. The other good memory was probably, it's a mixed feeling it was probably 1982 when Juventus came over after Italy won the World Cup. They came over with all their stars. And, you know, not just the Italian ones, Platini and Boniac were there too. Dino Zoff and goal and Paolo Rossi. And there were 45,000 people at Varsity for that. For the wrong reasons. They were there to see Juventus, not the Blizzard. But it was one of those great moments. And the fact that I believe the game was a 0-0 draw, if I recall correctly. We beat them next year. So those types of things are what stick in my mind. And it sure was a tough period in between. You know, it was hard, you know, hoping it would come back, but really, like you said, giving up.
Yeah.
So, you know, let's just hope that we can turn things around in the city and try and get back to something a little bit more encouraging.
Well, as bad as it is, at least we do still have a team in the city. It's how I try and think about it.
Yeah, no, fair enough. Absolutely. Totally true.
All right. On that depressing note, Dave, we do thank you for your time, Dave, and we appreciate it again, and we'll see you soon, Dave.
Take care, guys.
Thanks to Dave for joining us. And, you know, if I had a time machine, and that's a question you're going to hear two more times in this podcast, if I had a time machine, Kevin, I think I'd go back and I might join Dave in the stands that day. I definitely would go back and watch another game that we're going to talk to Bruce Wilson about in a minute. But certainly there's something, if you watch the video of those and if you watch some of the YouTube stuff out there, it's easy to find. That crowd, they were in it. And as Dave said, you know, I wasn't there, so I can't tell, but I'll take Dave's word that it's never been the same.
No, it really hasn't been the same because you're right. You talked about it in the intro. People, nowadays, it seems like soccer is still fighting to get back its place that it seems like it had before in North America. Well, that first installment of the NASL, it was there. People had a love. And when you're discovering something for the first time, there's always that... what's that? That beginner's luck, but that beginner's feeling too. That new, it's always
purity.
Yeah, it's pure. It's glamour. It's new for you. So it's new for everybody almost in the sense that you get to appreciate it, to love it, and to discover it only once. And that's what people felt. I still remember those videos with those great mullets in the stands, watching and falling in love with that sport.
And not to put too fine a point on it, but it's been 30 years as well since the Division 1A championship game has been played in this country. So that was the final night of that as well. But okay, on that note, Kevin, the next guest was an absolute privilege for me to talk to. One of my first heroes in the game was a no-nonsense defender by the name of Bruce Wilson, who was Canada's captain, who was epitomized the Canadian national team for years in those early days when it was... Well, it wasn't that hard to watch those games back then. They were played a little bit more. They were usually on tape delay, but CBC on Sports Saturday used to play those games, and that's where I first watched the Canadian national team and where I first developed an affinity towards kind of fullback or center backs, but pardon me, that didn't take any crap. And Bruce Wilson absolutely epitomized that. He was the guy that was the glue to that Canadian national team. He's maybe one of Canada's most underappreciated athletes of all time. How many Canadians have captained a team in the World Cup of Soccer, Kevin?
Only one, and it's Mr. Bruce Wilson.
All right, after this break, Bruce Wilson. Welcome back to the Two Solitudes special NASL 1.0 episode here, where we're talking about the end, 30 years on, of the NASL. We have Bruce Wilson on the line. He was the captain of Canada's 86 team. He was one of the players that played the most games all time in the NASL. And, you know, I don't want to age you, Bruce, but one of my childhood heroes watching growing up. So it's an honor to have Bruce on the line. Thanks.
It's great to be on the line.
Okay. Let's start with that final game in 84, because that is the genesis of this show. I don't know if a lot of Canadians know that the final ever game played in the NASL was played in Toronto at Varsity Stadium. You were involved in that game. What are your memories of that night?
Well, they weren't good, because we ended up losing, and it was the second soccer bowl in a row for Toronto. And, you know, we'd worked very hard. Bob Houghton put together a very good team. And both in 83 and 84, and we ended up in the final, you know, basically ahead of the Cosmos, et cetera. And we finished off on a bad note, but I can say this, that Toronto had come a long way in the North American League. I was lucky to play in four different cities, but Toronto was the last city I played with. And when I got there in 81, you know, the team was struggling a bit for sure in terms of making playoffs, et cetera, and when they brought Bob Houghton in and Clive Toy came in as basically a president, things changed, players changed, and, you know, if you look past those 3 or 4 years I was there, 4 years, we ended up in the final 2 years in a row, which is a huge credit to, I think, our team and the city of Toronto.
And Bruce, we talked to a fan that was involved in distributing tickets at the Duke of York before that game. He talked about having to talk his way into the pub, how it was an electric atmosphere in the stadium. Is that your recollection? What was it like? What were the fans like that night?
You know, they were. I mean, it was fantastic. People, you know, the league we knew was in dire straits. Well, you know, there's a lot of comments out there and whispers about Cosmos possibly going down, and of course we were more concerned in, you know, getting through the Soccer Bowl final and winning it. And but yes, there was a lot of interest. There was a lot of interest the year before, and I go back to 83 because Vancouver hosted the Soccer Bowl, and of course they expected to be there, and we knocked them out in the quarterfinals, which was absolutely not on to the Vancouver fans. 50,000 people, and we beat them 1-0. I'll never forget it. And we had to go down to, I think, San Jose. We knocked them off, and we made it to the final in Vancouver. So we had 50,000 people in 83 rooting for Tulsa, who we played in the final. All Canadians in Vancouver. We were not liked in Vancouver, that's for sure, because we knocked off their Whitecaps.
In 84, during the last game at the Varsity Stadium, we all knew how it ended with the coaches not respecting the tradition in the opposing locker rooms and all that. Did you get a feeling on the field of all what was going on behind the scenes?
Not really. We knew it was a double game, and, you know, it was not a traditional soccer bowl that we had over the 11 years I'd been involved. It was a little different. It was a home and away. And, you know, disappointing is the word for sure, because we ended up losing. I think the final score was 2-1, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, 3-2. 3-2.
3-2.
Huh?
Well, it was 3-2 in the second game. There was a 2-3. It was 3-2.
3-2, yeah. In the second game, and it was very close. But you know what? Already whispers had already started floating around not only the league, but the game and the week leading up to it. And they were not good whispers about the NASL.
You spoke about how it was not necessarily easy. In 84, it was a two-year bridge between 86. What did you do to stay in shape? Where did you train? What was that? Those 2 years in the darkness, we could say, before the World Cup?
Well, that's a great question. And, you know, it was a huge problem for Tony Waiters, our national coach. You know, in 84, if I can bring that up, in the national team, we actually made the quarterfinals of the Olympics, only to lose to Brazil in the quarterfinals on penalty shots. Which was, by the way, one of the biggest highlights of my life besides the World Cup. Mm-hmm. But 84 was good, and we were moving ahead, and then the league folded,
And you're right. You know, people were out of work. You know, we were qualifying in 85 for the World Cup. Nobody was basically playing anywhere. Some of them were playing in the MISL, the indoor league. But virtually, we basically had to keep together as a team on our own in different cities, training on our own, and we did it.
Bruce, it's a much different time now, of course, but talk about the early times in the NASL for you, how you broke in, what it meant for you as a player to have a North American option at that time.
Well, it was 74, actually. You know what? I graduated from UBC that April, and there was a trial game at Empire Stadium. We'll never forget it. And it was for the Whitecaps, and it was also for the national team. Eckhart Krautzen was in town, and Jimmy Easton, the new coach of the Whitecaps, was in town, and they put a game on. And after the game, I was selected to not only the Whitecaps, but the national team. So it was a very important game back then for me. And being able to play in Vancouver the first 4 years of the NASL for me was great, because I was able to play before my family and friends. The crowds were not very good. You know, our budget was very low, but we were in the North American Soccer League, and it was a start.
And of course, now nowadays you are working at the University of Victoria, where you've been for several years now. You know, working in the game still. How do you think that we can do more to get our kids more playing time at a higher level now? Was there more opportunity for you back then?
You know what? We were very fortunate in Vancouver, and partly because the ownership did not want to lay out a lot of money. So Jimmy Easton, who was a Scottish player, he basically was forced to sign all Canadian players with the exception of two or three imports. And there were good Canadian players in Vancouver. A lot of them played for Columbus, which is a local senior men's team in Vancouver. And you know what? We did all right. We were 500 in a professional league. But, you know, budgets were small. It gave Canadians a chance, Jimmy did, partly because he was forced to because of money. But without a doubt, there was 14, 15, 18 Canadians signed by Jimmy Easton who continued on, a lot of them, onto the national team program.
You mentioned earlier, Bruce, how the NASL had in 84 like a 2 out of 3 series for the Soccer Bowl. They were using different ideas and innovation back then for the NASL. Is there anything that Major League Soccer today or other NASL or USL Pro could learn from an open mind that they had in the late 70s?
You know what? Yeah, that's a good point. And I honestly think the NASL was a bit of a testing ground for FIFA around the world. We had some weird rules. We had a shootout, and it started out as penalty shots if the game was tied. And then they moved it to a shootout where the player dribbled in from the 35-yard line and had 5 seconds to release the ball. And you know what? People going to a game on a very hot day in the summer, if the score ended up 0-0 or 1-1 and people were walking around the field because of the heat, you know what? The shootout really did something for fans. Players, a lot of the good import players, did not like doing the shootout, that's for sure. But it was exciting. It was an exciting way to end the game, and it also created an extra point for the team that, you know, scored the most goals.
Bruce, I'm going to ask you one more NASL question, but before I do that, I think I'd be remiss if I didn't bring up that wonderful day in St. John's, Newfoundland in 1985 and ask you whether you were aware at the time of just how historic and how amazing that accomplishment was.
It was fantastic. I go back to, and people ask me all the time about being in the World Cup, being down in Mexico and playing against France and playing against whoever. You know what? Without a doubt, the biggest game for us, Canada, was the game in Newfoundland. And the way the game ended up in Newfoundland, in a way, it was ridiculous. The final game against Honduras wasn't played in Toronto or Montreal or Vancouver or Edmonton. We would have got 40 or 50,000 people at the game. But consequently, Soccer Canada, thinking that, there's a very good chance Canada will be long out of it, we'll put the game over in Newfoundland, and not a lot of expense needed, and we'll just go with it. And as it turned out, that final game, was the biggest game Canada's ever played. We played before 5,000 or 6,000 people in a Sid Park, bleachers around the field, King George V it was. And I'm going to tell you what, it was a great Canadian atmosphere. When we walked on the field, we felt that we were a goal ahead before the game began. We felt like the Hondurans feel playing in Honduras before 50,000 people. And it was a small crowd, but it was 100% Canadian, and it really helped us win that game.
Bruce, I don't know if this is a true story, but I've heard that there was a bunch of Hondurans that showed up at the St. John, New Brunswick airport.
That's a classic story. It's true. Yeah, they went to the wrong St. John's and missed the game, actually. Rather funny.
St. John, not St. John's.
Anyway. All right, the final question. We've asked everyone we've interviewed today, if you had a time machine and you could go back and you could re-experience one moment of your NASL experience, would you have one that you could point out?
You know what? I have a collection of many different feelings about the NASL. I was very fortunate to be at the right place at the right time in Vancouver at the right age. I had already just graduated from UBC, and, you know, I got to play in Chicago, New York, and Toronto, and Vancouver, and I have no regrets. I don't know. If I had to replay something, it would be the game in Vancouver, the final, in 83 against Tulsa. We ended up losing 2-0, I believe it was, and that was, without a doubt, was the biggest disappointment in my career.
All right, Bruce Wilson, we do appreciate your time. Canada's captain, always. Bruce, thanks again.
Not a problem.
Welcome back, and thanks again to Bruce for joining us. He joined us on very short notice. I emailed him in the morning, and he responded almost immediately, and we had him on less than an hour later. So thanks again, Bruce. Yeah, we mentioned briefly in that, Kevin, and I guess we would be remiss if we didn't expand on it a little bit. There was a bit of controversy that happened that night. Clive Toy, the man who was running the Blizzard, president, I believe was his title, refused to shake hands with his counterpart, the Sting. This went against all the protocol of the NASL and so on and so forth. It's one of those things that probably in retrospect doesn't seem as harsh or horrible as it did at the time, but it was hugely symbolic then, and it spoke to sort of a philosophical difference between the guys that were running the Blizzard and the guys that were running the Sting. The Sting were full-on moving towards indoor soccer at the time, and the phenomena of indoor soccer is something that we have trouble wrapping our heads around. But
it was big, I heard.
Yeah, it was huge back then. I remember as a kid, too, as a soccer fan, I used to have one of those big satellite dishes, you know, the ones that used to around the sky. Anyway, I have some funny stories about that I can't tell on air. But anyway, we used to flip around and we'd see the MISL all the time. It was one of the most, like, that in Mexican wrestling, where all the stuff you could get on the back channels. Like, watching
CMLL.
Tulsa. It's crazy. But, yeah, it wasn't ideal for producing national team players, really. But it certainly was one of the reasons why the NASL failed, because for some reason, you know, and you asked this about how the NASL used to do kind of different rules and was a little bit more flexible in how they interpreted the sport. And there were some positives about that. Ben Knight, for those that have listened to this podcast in the past in its previous incarnation, as it's called football, as the spiritual incarnation of that, would know that Ben Knight used to love the 35-yard line for offsides. He thought that was a rule that they should revisit. He thought that it opened up the game and et cetera, et cetera. It was simpler, blah, blah, blah. It's one of the things that they did back then. But one of the things that also led to, Kevin, is that they kind of, I didn't think, ever trusted that North American audiences would fully embrace the game as it was played in Europe. It's funny to hear that now, because everything in North America is about trying to emulate Europe now. But back then, they didn't, and I think the ultimate manifestation of that was indoor soccer.
What I'm wondering is, where would we be today if there was never any MISL or any indoor soccer? Where would the sport be if 20 years, more than 20 years, 30 years of non-stop professional top-flight league outside on grass would have made our country today.
Absolutely. And as I said in the intro, I think that the death of the NASL hurt Canada as much as anyone. We never regained that. I mean, the only other blip corresponds with the CSL's years. And I think there's no coincidence to that, which is why we desperately need the NASL 2.0 to follow through on those expansion promises to increase its foothold here, hopefully with a 1A league. On that note, that's when I first started to think about this show, as I said before, there's only one person that I really absolutely need to have, and that's Bob Lenarduzzi. And that's because he's a guy that's played and managed and been in the ownership side and on the management side at every level, at every step of the way since 1974 in Canadian soccer. So without any further ado, let's bring Bob on and have a chat about the NASL's influence both on the West Coast and overall as a Canadian. Special NASL edition where we talk about the end of the original NASL, the NASL 1.0, we're calling it. We're happy to have Bob Lenarduzzi on the line from Vancouver. He's, of course, the president of the Whitecaps out there now, but we're not going to talk about the MLS today. We're going to keep it focused on his experience as sort of a lifelong Whitecap. Bob, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
You of course, had a long playing career with them. It started in England. You came back. Just talk about your experience as a player in that league, what it was like to be part of what was a phenomenon that rose very quickly and then unfortunately dropped off.
Yeah, well, when I went to England in 1970, or 69 actually, I was 14, and I had visions of a professional career and playing at Wembley Stadium and all sorts of good things. And I was there for 5 years, and for two of those 5 years, I came back on loan to the Whitecaps from Reading. And it was tough going in those early years. The crowds were minimal. There wasn't a great deal of interest. And I decided to come back from England after my second year on loan to the Whitecaps and just get on with my life, whether that was going to be in soccer with the Whitecaps or elsewhere. I decided that it was time to make that move. And the irony is, within 3 years, the Whitecaps went from very little significance in the community to the top pro sports team in the marketplace, ahead of the Canucks and ahead of the Lions. And that took place, the start of it took place in 1977, and we started to get better crowds and started to bring in players from abroad that were mostly from England that were very, very good first division players and players that I had watched play when I was at Reading. And that all culminated in 79 with the Soccer Bowl run. And when we beat New York in the semifinal at Giant Stadium, I don't think the league were overly excited with the fact that we'd beaten the Cosmos because they were hosting the final the following week. And, of course, they're out, and Vancouver's playing Tampa in the final. And when we beat Tampa in the final, came back to Vancouver and had the approximate numbers are around 100,000 people in downtown Vancouver to welcome us back, and it was incredible how it had gone from very little recognition to all of a sudden being the toast of the town. And the following year, we benefited from that. We had 22,000 season tickets. We had an average attendance of 28,000, and it looked like the game was here to stay. And as it happens, that wasn't going to be the case. And as quick as our ascent was from 74 to 79, the descent was just as quick from 79 to 84, in that the league ceased to exist in 1984. And it seemed incredible that that could happen when you look back at the heights of the late 70s.
If you could focus on the end, 83, 84,
Your attendance wasn't that bad in 83, if memory serves, was it not?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear that, Duane.
Okay. Kevin, just do some editing magic after that. If you look at in the 80s, those last couple years, Bob, could you just sort of, the best you can, look back and try and understand what happened and where the state of the game was in 1984 when the decision was made to pull the plug?
Yeah, I think as good as the Cosmos were, and Pelé and Beckenbauer and Canalia, those players were for the game in terms of the heightened awareness that they brought to the league at that time. It seems ridiculous to suggest that could also have been the downfall of the league, because other clubs tried to keep up with the Cosmos and were bringing in players and spending a great deal of money, but it wasn't reflecting in bums and seats. So, and the ownership at that point, they're unlike now in MLS, where the franchise fee is significant, the investment in stadium and facilities is significant. Back then, all you needed to do was put up your money, and I'm not even sure what the franchise fees were. I'm assuming there weren't a lot, and you had yourself a franchise. So it was easy to get in, but it was also easy to get out. And the numbers were quite shocking from over the course of those last 3 years. I believe at the height of it all, we were at actually 25 teams, I believe, and we were losing 5 per season over those last 3 years. So we went from being a significant number of teams in the league to, in the end, down to 9, and that's when the league called a day. So I do believe that owners getting involved, not having a great stake in the game, and then seeing that their investment wasn't being returned by the fans or by partnership or by sponsors, it was easy to just say, well, enough of that, I'll move on to my next project.
If we go back to 1979, the heyday of the Whitecaps and the 1.0 version of the NASL, as a player, Bob, did you have a feeling that the league was going to disappear 5 years from there, or did you have the feeling that you were on top of the world, it was going to stay forever?
The latter, for sure. I was 24 years old, and I was playing professional soccer in the city that I was born and raised, and we were playing in front of 28,000-plus people on a regular basis. The Cosmos were drawing well. Seattle Sounders, Portland were doing well. But there weren't enough of those, and so I didn't see, if anybody had said to me then that, hey, you know what, in 5 years you're going to be looking for something else to do, I would have said there's no way. The game appears to be in a growth spurt, and there's a real cause for optimism. But when it started to crumble, it crumbled fast, and you could literally see it happen before your eyes.
As an original homegrown player, we could say, for all the North American players as well, how important was the NASL in the 1979 era, and even up until 1984, how important was that league for those players?
Well, it was interesting then, because in 79, and I'm not sure where we got to by the league's demise in 84, but in 1979, you had to play two Canadian players, or two North American players, in the starting 11. And so for me, that was fantastic. My hope is that myself and others that did play would have done it on ability as opposed to legislation, but the fact that it was legislated meant that we did get an opportunity to play. And I actually feel like the heyday of the professional game did link to our best results on the international stage as well. And when you look at that group of players that qualified and got to the quarterfinals of the 1984 Olympics, and the same group of players then qualified for the World Cup in 86. Most of those players played with and against very good players in the North American Soccer League, and I do believe that it definitely helped our development.
Bob, as someone deeply involved on a management level, Is there any lessons you take from the demise of NASL on a day-to-day basis? I mean, obviously they're not conscious day-to-day, but is there any lessons that you take and bring forth to today in the running of a professional team?
Well, I actually feel that we're one of 19 teams as it currently stands, and next year we'll be one of 20, and by the time we get two or three years down the road, we'll be one of 24. So for me, it really is important how you run your own club, but I do feel that MLS have done a real good job of adhering to those lessons. And when you look back at the legacy of the 1994 World Cup, and that being, for me, MLS, and you look at some of those original owners, the Hunt family, the Ansuit family, and the Kraft group, are all still involved in the sport. But when they got involved in the startup of MLS, they were three of the biggest stakeholders. And the same thing started to happen to MLS that had happened to the NASL, that looked like it was starting to regress, and in fact lost two teams in Florida, Tampa Bay and Fort Lauderdale. And it looked like, well, here we go again. Those three ownership groups, really, we should all be very thankful to, because they owned all 10 teams that were left. And when you consider the amount of business acumen amongst those three groups, you have to think that they had a vision, that they could look ahead and that they could see, okay, it's worth, let's put some money to this, because we need to just stay the course, and we need to let the interest in our game catch us up. And sure enough, that did happen, and they've divested themselves of those teams, and I don't think they have any more than one team at this time each. And so that, to me, is the success of our league. We've looked at it from the point of view of, we can only be as strong as our weakest link. And yes, there are some weak links right now, but when you look at expansion, when you look at Manchester City and even more so, you look at the New York Yankees getting involved in professional soccer in North America. Why are they getting involved in professional soccer? They're getting involved because they see a business opportunity. There's no doubt in my mind why they're in the game at this point. And so it's gone from being something that people loved to do in the original NASL or in the NASL days, to now being something that obviously people love to do. But there's also that business element that is very significant.
There's a very direct tie between the NASL years in Vancouver and today, and that's the name. And it's obvious direct tie. Mm-hmm. You also celebrated your 40th anniversary this year of the birth of that name. Talk about the decision to move from the 86ers name to the Whitecaps, and how important it was to repair those direct connections.
Yeah, there's an interesting backstory to that, because when we started up the 86ers, Tony Waiters was the catalyst behind that on the heels of the World Cup, or even prior to going to the World Cup. The talk of a Canadian Soccer League starting up and the team being in Vancouver and being a part of that league was something that people were rallying around. And wasn't necessarily people with deep pockets. It was people that loved the game, loved what the Whitecaps brought to our city, and it started up on a very minimal budget. And so when we were deciding on what the name would be, I was actually an advocate for the Whitecaps name, given that it had only been 2 years since the NASL folded, and a lot of the group felt at that point that. And now, a long while after the fact, I actually agree with them that it was too close, and there were a lot of unhappy people, given that the way that the team had folded, and there were lots of people that were owed money in the market, and the feeling was that we need to start afresh, and hence the 86ers. So the fact that we had time to, and I think the 86ers did their bit in terms of maintaining an interest in this market, and we had sellout crowds at Swangard Stadium, 5,000 plus on a regular basis. And we hadn't actually gone to MLS when we did revert back to the Whitecaps name, but I believe that was in 1999 that we did revert back to the Whitecaps name. And I think enough time had passed at that point that the goodwill in the Whitecaps name and the relevance to the Whitecaps name to our city. And on a day like today, if you were to drive over the Lionsgate Bridge into downtown yesterday in particular, where there's a strong wind, you'll see Whitecaps on the water and you'll see Whitecaps on the mountains. And so it really is, I think it's a great name, and there's a lot of history attached to that name as well. So we did go through some spells where it was should we or shouldn't we, but I think in retrospect, it all kind of worked out the way that it needed to.
We've been watching a lot of NASL games from that era getting ready for this show, and one thing we really noticed was the different type of play that the players used to play, a more aerial focus than... Was it noticeable, the arrival of international stars in the heyday of the NASL, the different type of play between the players?
Well, I can give you a great example of one player that altered our style, and he came to us in the middle of the 1979 season. And we'd gone 10-5 in the first part of the season, which was a good record, and we looked like we would get to the playoffs and give people a pretty good run. But Tony Waiters and Bob McNabb brought in Alan Ball at that point, and Alan Ball had been playing in Philadelphia at the time and wasn't overly happy with what was going on there. So we brought him in, and our style changed almost upon his arrival. And I was playing at right back and at left back at times throughout that season and the following season. And it was interesting because Alan Ball would come short to get the ball off of me, and we were set up to play a certain way. It was to hit the front man and ideally have him hold it up and link people in and make our way up the field that way. But and so every time I missed him out, he kind of looked at me and didn't look overly happy. And at halftime of one of those first games, he came over to me, sat beside me, said, "Hey," he said, "why aren't you giving me the ball?" I said, "Well, our what we've been told to do is just hit the front man." He said, "I'll tell you what," he said, "when I ask for the ball, even if I've got a guy up my ass, you give me the ball, and if I give it back to you, then you can do what you want with it. But when I ask for it, you give it to me." And after that, I gave it to him every time he asked for it, and what a wonderful player he was. And he wasn't a physical specimen. He had a squeaky voice, but it was a guy that would make things happen, and his passes would tell you what to do with the ball when you receive it. If he passed it to you, to your feet, it meant he knew you were being closed down. If he knew you had space to run on, he'd play it in front of you. And just a fantastic player for us to have come in at that time of the year. And I'm, as much as we had a very, very good side, I think he was the final piece to the puzzle that made us a championship team that year. And unfortunately, he has passed away, but a real character both on and off the field.
Bob, we thank you for your time, but we will end it with this. If you had a time machine and you could go back and you could relive one specific moment of your time in NASL, what would that be?
Yeah, there's many, but in particular, and it wasn't the championship game in 79, and if you've got this one in your library from the NASL days, it's well worth watching. We had played the LA Aztecs in Los Angeles in the first of a two-legged final. We're up 2-0, ended up conceding two late goals, and lost in a shootout. And the shootout was memorable because Johan Cruyff at that time decided that he was going to, and it was on a grass surface, so the bounce wasn't clean. He decided he would flip the ball up in the air and actually juggle it towards the goal. And what that did was it really hindered Phil Parks, who was our keeper at the time, his decision-making, because if he came out, he'd get lobbed. If he stayed on his line, he's getting closer and closer, and he'd just wallop it. So he decided to stay, and right up till about 8 yards, Cruyff just juggled it, and he knew he had 5 seconds, and just volleyed it into the net. So that ended up winning the game for them. We had to come back to Vancouver, and we needed to win two games. And what I remember the most was walking out of the tunnel at the old Empire Stadium and getting goosebumps now, as I actually retell the story of the atmosphere in the building. And because the game was sold out, it was live on, the blackout had been lifted, it was live in Vancouver as well. And we were so disciplined that night. We ended up winning the first game, and then we went to the either, whatever way you look at it, memorable shoot or memorable mini game or not in some people's opinions, but we ended up going to that and won that as well. So we ended up getting past them and then playing New York in the semifinal. So that night is still embedded and edited in my mind.
Bob Lenarduzzi, Vancouver Whitecaps legend, I suppose is the only way to say it. Lifelong member, Bob, we do thank you for your time today.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
Welcome back, and thanks again to all three guys for taking time. If we had more time to do this, we could talk all day about this. We thought it might get a little bit repetitive, but I think the people like to hear the stories. And Kevin and I were talking, too, that it makes sense that we might have to do this again to look at that 85-86 Canada team next year. So that might be a long-term project that we're working on, right, Kevin?
Absolutely, especially when Bruce explained to us the 2 years of darkness between the end of the NSL and the starting of that World Cup, where he had to fight just to get the practice field just to stay in shape. So there's a lot of stories we could go with that 86 team.
Yeah, and look, the legacy of the NSL was that it taught some people some lessons on how to run the game here in this part of the world. You know, we get frustrated with MLS in terms of its conservatism sometimes, but there's no doubt that in the early days, especially in the early 2000s when they were retracting teams, although they just retracted one this year too, but at any rate, in that era, it was necessary to live by those lessons. And maybe now, finally, 20 years on of MLS history, we're in a situation where we may be able to move a little bit and open things a little bit up with the CBA negotiations upcoming. We'll see. However, it's not about MLS today. It's about the NASL legacy in this country. And just as a final thought, Kevin, again, I just stress it. We think of the NASL and we think of Canadian soccer as always being a failure. It wasn't. There was a lot of success stories. There was a lot of success stories in the NASL, and there were a lot of success stories in the NASL in Canada. And that led to the ultimate success story of the 1986 World Cup appearance by the Canadian national team. I think that if we build upon things and we grow leagues, that things can happen, and that's the lesson. And hopefully, as we look at the possibility of NASL expanding and creating more teams up here and maybe ultimately a division that's only in Canada, that's why we need to hope for that.
I agree, and I hope you enjoyed that trip back in the early 80s. And until next time, back in the present era, have a great soccer.